When Rose first asked me, you know, to do this, I had no idea what she was talking about in any way whatsoever. And even when she explained to me, I still had no idea what she was talking about. So I thought that we could, you know, pursue that in a very particular way. Interpreting live bathing, obviously it's related to the sign that we see above, so we have our visual for the evening.
Our single visual for the evening.
So, Kirk, do you want to give your version of events, and then we'll go over to Joe.
So, we were driving to Austin from College Station, where I was in school, Joe was bringing art exhibits there. We were driving down the road, I was driving, we passed a sign, and it had the shape of a fish and it had the word bait on it. And we passed by and I made a comment and I said, I guess they sell minnows. And Joe said, no, they sell worms. And I said, well, there was a picture of a fish. And he said, no, there was no picture of a fish. It's fish bait is what it said. And I made a U-turn, of course. You can't let something like that slide. And we went back and looked at the sign, and the sign looked like this. And that's really, it's a touchstone. We argued about that sign and the way we perceive all the way for the 2 hours, presumably went to go see a film, all the way back the 2 hours. And every time we see each other, some aspect of that, it's kind of like a touchstone. There's some way that we perceive that's different. I contend that I'm a more of a visual person. I saw the fish, and that was the key element to me in the sign, and that's why I went to minnows, because that is a fish. That's my side of the story.
Joan, come on, let's get your version of events.
Yeah, my version is just slightly different. There's three of us in the car, because Bill Hyde was in the back, if you will recall.
Yeah.
Yes, he was.
Boys, calm down, maybe you start.
And so we're driving along, and we pass this sign. Not that sign. We pass a sign, but it looks a lot like that. And I say, so do we need worms? And Kirk says, what are you talking about? That guy sells minnows. And I said, no, he doesn't. He sells fish bait. And so I don't even remember turning back to look at the sign. And meanwhile, Bill in the back saying, what sign? Anyway, so that's our memory of it. But we did discuss it for a long time. And even today, you know, it's the joke that comes back to haunt us, because every time, we've looked at a lot of art together. We've traveled together and looked at art together. And even though we are attracted to the same works, we are responding aesthetically to similar works or the same works, the way we respond to them are completely different. The language we're using is different. The perceptual apparatus appears to be different. And it was at that point, you know, I was doing art exhibits already. I was organizing exhibits and for the public, for a student at a university. And so it was like, holy cow, what the hell have I been doing if there are people in the world like that?
But on the other hand, though, what we should say is, why create that image at all?
Just as a hint, it's just sort of like, I got a kick out of it because it does look similar to it. My memory of the sign is that it was in the shape of a fish rather than a fish drawn on a piece of wood. But hell, what do I know? Kirk has better memory than I do.
Okay. I mean, in a funny sense, if that was the case, it's interesting that you still thought that it was about text.
There was the word bait in the center.
Yeah.
And so I translated the shape of the fish into the word fish, and then the word bait to construct fish bait. And for me, as a South Texas fisher boy, I never used minnows, I only used worms.
Okay. Let's take this forward then, in the sense that, you know, you say it's a touchstone for you, and it's quite obviously an important touchstone in the way that you've crudely become, you know, sort of visual text sort of divided. When is there an occasion where that was really pronounced? I mean, was there a particular occasion, for example, when you were in, I don't know, an exhibition or a particular kind of area where this debate kind of, I suppose, got heated, where you found yourself feeling that, you know, the textual version of events was the primary one?
It got heated in when we drove by the sign. I mean, we heatedly debated it for two hours.
Yeah. And what was the heart of that conversation?
Yeah, the heart of the conversation was whether a visual, whether an image is a language or not. And I contend that you do not have to translate it into words. You see something and you don't have to translate that into words. You respond to it without words. And
at that time, I didn't buy into that at all. And 20 years have elapsed, but at that time I was adamantly opposed, by virtue of not having experienced it, to the notion that it was possible to engage in any cognitive kind of experience without having language associated with it.
Without having words associated with it.
Language.
Right, that's the argument. It is a language.
No, but language.
Visual language.
Tongue. Language. I mean, okay, so there are, so the signification systems, you know, which could be visual or linguistic or verbal or whatever. I mean, there are ways of representing things. Over time, we come to these various discourses in which, you know, if we're going to have a signifying system, a way of representing ideas, then what are the various ways in which we do it? And so we use terms like musical language and verbal language and visual language. We always attach that weird word language to it, even though language is rooted in the tongue. Last night at dinner, I said, you know, it is possible to engage in a apprehension that's completely that has no purse associated with it, no icon, no sign, no symbol, because it's so pre-verbal, it's so prehensive. It's like an emotive response to a visual system.
Right. I mean, perceptions are shaped by cultures, for sure. And that's one of the ways that we figure out what we see, is from our whole cultural baggage. And certainly my interest is, how do we break free from some of that? How do we, like, see it from a different point of view? Because that's the thing that's interesting to me, is to keep seeing things anew, keep perceiving things differently than we perceived them before. The first people that saw films ran out of the movie theaters because they thought it was coming at them. Well, we don't do that anymore, not even remotely. And
we still enjoy them.
But we still enjoy them, and they still enjoyed them. But it's because we have some knowledge of that now, we see things in a different way. What are all the things that we don't see at all?